How much of what Angelcube provided was awesome access to capital, and how much of it was awesome access to people who helped you grow your business?
I'll just keep yourself by saying that 20 grand doesn't go very far. If you think that the 20 grand is going to pave the path to stardom, then you are kidding yourself. So essentially that 20 grand is basically a token amount to allow you guys to start to experiment. So with this 13-week program, you're running a whole bunch of iterations. You're changing your product every week. So that 20 grand goes on things like experimental marketing campaigns, on marketing channels that you otherwise wouldn't have been in a position to experiment with. It goes towards maybe pushing your product into different sections, whether it be like into magazines or other channels of revenue. But do any of you guys have an answer for that?
Yeah, I actually talked about it before. So Angelcube provides this really good structure throughout the week, and probably about 2 to 3 times every week they bring in these mentors who talk about their area of expertise. And then so they can usually help you at that stage, or it at the very minimum serves as an introduction, and then so you can just like ping them afterwards and catch up over coffee and then give them any questions that you might have, and they'll help you out then. And if not, if you're like more accelerated than the structure provides you, then you just ping Adrian or Nathan and they're like, all right, I'm connecting you with this person, and it just happens really well like that.
Startups is all about the people. It's definitely not about the money. It's definitely not about any of this sort of stuff. Like what Angelcube does, hopefully better and better every year, is we develop a network of people who are going to help propel you as a Melbourne-based startup onto the global stage. Next question.
You mentioned that you spend a bit of time over the 13 weeks through a structured program so that the startups can effectively identify product market fit. I'm just curious from these guys, there's a lot of material these days out there around, a lot of the lean methodologies and the frameworks. Some of it is a lot easier to read than apply. So I'm just curious from everybody there, how much time you spent prior to Angelcube actually trying to apply that versus how much you read about it in terms of theory. So I guess did the structure of the program help you leverage some of those frameworks and those things?
I've always been of the belief that sometimes an idea needs time to evolve. So the week-by-week structure didn't perfectly suit me, but what it did mean is that I could never settle down. I could never relax and assume that something was perfect. I always needed something to prove, and it kept pushing me forwards. In truth, Tableau only achieved a reasonable level of product market fit in November, so 2 months after Angelcube finished. But it wouldn't have gotten there without the week-by-week iterations, because it kept pushing the product forward. And it's as much about getting you into that mindset of looking for things to change and getting into a mindset where you can build things and launch them within a week that pays off its value. So, yeah, the Lean Startup methodology works in the sense that you do learn a lot by changing stuff, but it's about pushing you beyond that time.
Just say, screw that. Just don't pay rent. Just don't eat. Just start. Like lean methodology is great, and people write books about it. But not being able to pay rent and not being able to eat will make you work hard, and it will make you produce the best product you can. Like we were struggling for rent before Angelcube. Still struggling for rent now. But that's it. It's lean start. They call it the lean methodology, but it's really just scraping and until you have something which the people love. And then it's like it clicks. You still can't pay rent, but it clicks. It's like, oh, it works. And that part is just gold. Like, it's awesome.
And the buzz of that product market fit when you get it, I mean, you think that maybe you've got it, but when it actually happens and you get that buzz, it is incredible. And it's worth not being able to pay rent or whatever other hardships you've had to go through. Because when people, like Charles was saying, when people like it, it's pretty incredible. And you can't fake that stuff. And these guys give you a kind of a framework to get there.
Another question?
I have one for Ash. Being a solo founder, do you have any technical skills or not?
It's progressing.
Okay. How did you find then going through the program with rapid iteration without having any hardcore?
It was really difficult because I was relying on a developer who was still at university. So they had their own spare time, which they dedicated to Tableau. And because they weren't within the Angelcube environment, they couldn't build as quickly as other people were. So that did slow me down. And with hindsight, yeah, it probably would have been better to bring someone on full-time into the program. So yeah, hopefully that answers the question.
I just wanted to know what you guys did to survive financial hardship after the 3 month program.
It's free pizza over there. No, I'm kidding. I really came for the pizza. There's you scrounge. Like, we were doing client work websites to try and pay rent. The 20 grand as Adrian said to us at the start, you can spend it on, you go on a surf trip for all he cares. But if the 20 grand for when you have some market fit, you can spend it on testing your market fit and scaling it. That's I can't say, like Ash said it before, we wouldn't be here without Angelcube. Like Adrian looked at us, as soon as we said to him we've got market fit, Adrian looked at us, blow the 20 grand tomorrow and prove it to me. So we went and blew the 20 grand, and although it went awesomely, it still could be better. And having that kind of push by these guys to say spend 20 grand tomorrow is awesome.
So just to paint a bit more of a picture, these guys had a revenue model where they were able to buy customers. So they were able to buy customers, and those customers would pay for their product. So essentially you'd spend $1 to acquire a customer, and that customer might then spend $2 or $3 on the platform. So there was a couple of dollars either way that they were finding anecdotally and through their testing that was able to generate income. So then essentially what they did was they used that 20 grand as sort of like a little bank, a kitty, to push money through one end to see what income would come out the other. And then they played with all the different factors along the way to try and extract more money out of the customers, to have like higher lifetime value. So maybe they have fewer customers, but the customers would spend more or stick around for longer. Or perhaps they were more viral. So essentially they would invite in other customers who would then increase the customer base overall. So these are the sorts of experiments that you go there. Any other questions? Go ahead.
We hear a lot about consumer-based products and services coming out of Angelcube. Do you have an example of a B2B?
Yeah. So in the last batch, there was a company called eTasker. eTasker is an online marketplace. It's a marketplace for enterprise. So think about it as like TaskRabbit, but for enterprise. So essentially, the pitch is that corporates work in silos. So teams and areas of expertise are often in isolation to the rest of the company. So you think about things like Yammer. They break down those silos by just having a big all-in feed of information. eTasker, on the other hand, essentially allows you to utilize expertise within the company that isn't inside your team by having a task marketplace.
Okay, I've heard of eTasker. Where are they at in the process now?
At the moment, eTasker have a pilot with a large, I think they were in late stage talks with Deloitte, and they came out of KPMG, so they had an existing relationship with KPMG. So they're running a pilot program within that company. One of the challenges with B2B, especially around the enterprise space, is that you have a slow sales cycle. So again, a challenge of being a sole founder is the fact that it's hard to iterate quickly. The challenge of being an enterprise-focused company is the fact that the sales cycle often takes months. So a 13-week program, the effectiveness within that to be able to iterate on your product is definitely lower. So there's more challenges involved. Does anyone have anything to talk about your customer? Cool. Go ahead.
You said that you don't really like single founders. So I just wanted to understand why Ash got accepted to the team. Because sometimes when you're a single founder, it's not really your choice. Sometimes it's either because you can't afford paying other people, or because you haven't found the right people yet to work with.
Sure. Yeah, I mean, like my answer to that is, like, as a founder, you have a whole lot of jobs that you have to do. Your first job is to sell your idea to a co-founder. That's what it is. Later on, you'll be selling it to investors. Earlier before that, you'll be selling it to customers. But first off, you have to sell it to someone who can jump on board your vision, and you can invoke as much rigor for that idea as you have. So they come along for the sleepless nights, for the, 20-hour days, for everything that's involved in taking on that. Because doing it as a solo founder, I mean, honestly, Ash is lucky, and he's an exception.
Yeah, but I was trying to understand that, yeah, setting your ID sometimes is not that hard, but it's also finding the right people that can bring value and resources into your business compared to what you have already for you. So, of course, yeah, finding the right people with complementary skills to you, and that's not always easy. So my question was basically, is it something that can come after or during the program, or is it something that you need to add first before you apply?
So applications open at the end of the month. The program will start in May. You have that period of time to get a co-founder. Go ahead.
Well, my question, as much as I appreciate the fact that you only want pizza and stuff like that, but you know, I'm coming with the setup, and I'll just set the stage a little bit. I've got a mortgage to pay, I've got a wife, and I've got a kid, right? So as much as I like that, my wife would probably say, go sit on the footpath with your laptop, because there's no electricity in the house, right? So I just want to ask you a direct question. What is the setup for people who have a full-time job? And look, don't get me wrong, I'm very serious about that. I'm very passionate about it. I've been working for a very long time, pretty hard job. But what is the avenue for people who have a job and probably have other commitments? How do we fit into the program? Do we fit into the program? I understand it's a very intensive program for 13 weeks, you know, got commitments. Even though we put that commitment, how flexible is it to adjust personal life versus
quit your job? I mean, I'm dead serious. Like, we're doing this 18 hour, you know, like, there's long days. And I have a girlfriend, just that much. She's, yeah, it's tough. But you can do it. It's the drive. It's getting up every day. It's what these guys talk about. You can't sleep. You think about coding. You think about, you can do it. It's just your drive. It's nothing. The mortgage. If you got savings, yeah, it's awesome.
Is there a flexibility in the group? Like, you know, at the end of the day, commitment is a commitment. And how do we, I don't know if other people in this forum have the same problem that I do. So I just want to understand, is there a flexibility in the program, or, you know, I should just think about, you know, an alternate way? Because it's either way, I'm going to go with it.
I'll let Nathan answer a bit about the flexibility, but I was in the same position you were. Two kids, wife, mortgage. I live about an hour out of town. I just decided that I was compelled to do this. I didn't think about consequences. Some people would say that's bad, but so I just rocked up on the first day and thought, oh, if I get through the first week, that's awesome. And then I just got so much value out of it. I had a couple of things on the side. I was making apps at the time, so I just keep doing that at night. But then within weeks, you know, like I said, I was getting so much value out of Angelcube, I just stopped doing that. Just let those tick away in the background. The other thing is, I agree with what everyone's saying, the Lean Startup and stuff like that. Wasn't exactly my experience. I bought a new car 3 weeks into Angelcube. It's a nice car too. So I don't think it has to be, you know, the starving artist approach to startups. It really can be whatever you want it to be, whatever suits where you're at. So if that's buying new cars, or if that's eating ramen noodles, you know, nice flavourings, of course, but then that's fine. So whatever works for you, I think.
With a quick one on flexibility, in the last round that we had, there was a couple of guys that came out of the KPMG innovation department. They came in and pitched us. They were fantastic. One was a super talented developer. One was a hustler that could sell you like sand in the desert. They came into the program. We accepted one of them in, and then as soon as they invited us in, they called us and said, "Hey, we gotta quit our jobs at KPMG. You gotta give 2 weeks leave and all those sorts of things." Could be as long as 6 weeks before we can come into the program. And what we just said to them, like in the same way that your first job as a founder will be to find a co-founder if you're a sole founder, your first job as a founder, if you make it into the program, and well, irrespective of whether you make it into the program, if you're going to be a founder and be serious about your startup, your first job is to quit your job.
My team were on 3 different continents when we got the news that we got in, and it was a Monday, and we had to be here on the Friday. So that gives you an idea of kind of the turnaround you can achieve if you have to. We just packed up and got here. So
I'm sorry you weren't clear, you still got your wife with you.
Yes, I do. I see them a little less than I used to. But in all honesty, like, the quality of my family life now is better than it's ever been. They're on the journey with me and they're excited about what we're doing as I am.
Like to know, it sounds to me incredibly expensive to go on the program because 10% of equity in startup I would value at around $200,000. And I'm just saying,
I take investment from that guy.
Is there a point that you get from Angelcube really worth $200,000 when you are really in the startup phase, when you're bleeding that kind of equity away? And it just sounds incredibly expensive to me.
Sure. Who wants to answer that question?
Ash.
Just bite your tongue and do it. You know, if you look at equations and everything, then you'll think, well, 10% of value, you feel like you're giving a lot away, but you won't remember that you've given it away a week into the program. That's not to say that you shouldn't. I'm saying that having them on board will add more than 10% to the value of your company. It's a difficult decision to make. I struggled with that decision, which is why I tried to negotiate Adrian down, but the company is more than 10 times greater in value because of Angelcube.
It's not the only option that you have. That's what I'm saying. It's a lot of money to spend for this option.
It is. We, for example, we walked into the program with the app built. At that time, I don't know if you've tried to raise money in Australia, but unless you're digging a hole and digging up gold or iron ore, people laugh at you. Like, like raising money in Australia is near impossible without a network. And that's what you get. You don't. It's not so much what we got at the start, it's what we got at the end. So it's the people these guys know, and it's their mentor network that know. We just need to reach out to the mentor network and say, we're going to raise $500,000. The other day, we got an email from one of the richest people in Australia about the Flappy Birds thing, saying, ha ha, Jim, you've seen Flappy Birds? It's like, oh, that's really cool. He's like, really rich. And he's emailing us. It's that network that we would have never got to speak to before if it wasn't for being an Angelcube. So that's, it's hard to express the value at the start. It's at the end you see that emerge and that network of people who will invest in tech emerge, which is.
Go ahead.
Does Angelcube also provide references to form the team? Or does it have to be sorted out by yourself
before
you
even apply? Yeah, so I think in the lead up to applications closing, we might hold like a co-founder speed dating event, probably in conjunction with Lean Startup and Startup Vic. And that's an opportunity for you as a founder or a non-technical founder to be sort of meet and fall in love with a technical founder. And vice versa, if you're a technical person, you might meet the business co-founder of your dreams. But essentially, it's very much up to you again. Like, you have no idea the challenges that will be in your pipeline as you move forward. Like, at the end of the 13 weeks, you're gonna be sitting in meetings, pitching to VCs and to angels. Like, you have to be everything that you are and about 1,000% more. So that starts from the minute that you get into the program. That starts with, consummating that marriage. Like, finding the person that you're looking for, working out whether it's going to work between the two of you, and really, you know, setting yourself up.
So this happens before the application?
Yeah, I'll talk to Scott. We'll see if we can make something happen in the next 6 weeks.
Just following back up on that, Harold, ideas are a dime a dozen. All of us have ideas, but it seems like a lot of people I've talked to like that technical co-founder. What would you think a person who has an idea or a dream, but without the technical knowledge to bring it to reality, have to do to make it appealing enough for someone to get on board and work with them? To do that?
It's really difficult. You know, to use the metaphor, it is like a marriage. And you know, I push what Nathan said there. I find it hard to find someone and marry them within 4 weeks. That's my own personal opinion. Don't try and force it. When you find the right person, they will, you know, you'll notice. I had my potential co-founder leave on me, like a big breakup, in September, when we were going through the biggest phase of our growth. And that was a really painful time for the startup. But, you know, I learned to move on and look for someone else. I know I sound this like a tragic. I should be holding a box of tissues with the notebook theme music going on in the background. don't try and force finding a co-founder. Focus on your users, you'll find a way. Contract people. That's what I did. I contracted someone to start building an early phase of the product, and yeah, eventually built up enough revenue to keep paying them, offered them a full-time role, they left, and then I'm raising money to find more people.
You talked about the iterative process to put the companies through. I guess Angelcube is kind of your startup, your company. Can you tell us a bit about the learnings and the iterative process that Angelcube has gone through?
Yeah, absolutely. So we very much think of Angelcube as a startup itself. Our program has evolved very much over the years. This will be our fourth intake. In the first intake, it was very, very structured. We basically had a really crystal clear idea about exactly what we wanted each startup to go through at each part of the 13-week program. The minute we started to implement that, we realized pretty quickly that different startups were at different stages of their journey, and they're perceptive to different types of ideas, different types of people, and they just need different things to get by. And so basically, one of the reasons why we limit the intake, we would never take on any more than, say, 10 in an intake, for the reason that there's a lot of face time, there's a lot of customization that the program goes into actually customizing every message to these startups. So for example, different investors come in and talk to different startups, different mentors can appeal to the needs of different startups at different times and for different reasons. So that's one big learning for us. Implementing the Monday and Friday top and tail of the week thing was something that worked quite well last year. We're always changing the way that we do things. There was far more FaceTime and far more mentor sessions in, I think, Phil's session than there were in last year's session, just because we found that startups were blind and they didn't have enough time to build, right? So we're always changing the shape of the program, and this year it won't be any different.
Sorry to ask a secondary question. Is there communication between other parties, or are they competition?
Oh, I mean, without a doubt, the first time we ran an Angelcube program, it was very much based on your Y Combinator style program. But I mean, you have different incubators all around the world who do things slightly differently. So we were a part of the Techstars network initially, and we got some insight into the way that they ran their programs. We were looking at YC, we were looking at 500 startups. We're very close with Nikki Shabak up in Startmate and the way that they run their programs. Different programs essentially run differently for them. And I think the main reason is that the environment that they're in is different. So one of the things that's valuable with the Angelcube program is our mentors care a lot. So for example, one of the mentors is now directly involved in Phil's company, LifeX. They were a mentor in the Angelcube program, and they're now sitting inside the company, and they're active investors and actively working in that company. Being in this kind of co-working space, this is the cultural home of tech startups in Melbourne. So we utilize that, we use that as a strength rather than ignore it. If we're tucked away in Caroline Springs somewhere, and you're working away in a place out there, it would be a completely different vibe. Yeah, makes sense. Go ahead.
Yeah, obviously you've got life. So that's an example of something hardware based. Would you say you're strongly focused on software, or you also like to see applications of hardware stuff?
We're strongly focused on aggressively successful global startups. So anything that can scale in that way, we're on board with. So we, in our first batch, we're we shouldn't do anything social because it sends out the wrong kinds of signals. It's going to be really hard to stay onto a social company that will have success. They won't see that success for years to come. But then we ended up funding good films, which then went on to have follow-on funding and saw some really impressive growth there for a long time. So the rules that we set from day one, we broke in day two. So we don't try and pretend that we know exactly what types of startups we're going to invest in. It's more about identifying that talent within the team. It's the teams that make these things work and make these things successful. Yeah.
But do you want to add anything to that?
Not really.
Again, also, you come into the program with an idea, and then that might not be the same idea that you leave with.
So to give you an example, App.io was one of the guys that I spoke about before. He went on to raise an A round. They came into the program with no idea. And I don't mean like no idea. I mean they did not have an idea. They were just an awesome team of developers who shipped some incredible stuff before. We could identify the fact that they were talented guys and they knew how to iterate, they knew how to like engage with customers. And from the day one, like a lot of the other teams were talking about like how to ship their product, how to get more customers, all those sorts of things. These guys were going, okay, how do we come up with an awesome idea? So they were back in ideation phase from day one. But that's just like, again, these guys were at a different stage of the product, different stage of their cycle as a startup. And they've been, you know, very successful. Go ahead.
You just mentioned that the founder or the co-founder, one has to be technical and the other one has to be a business-minded thing. Does it necessarily work that way or can both of them be technical as well?
Both of them can be technical, so if you have like one of each, then you tend to see balance. If you have two technical co-founders, then one of you is going to have to do things that a biz dev co-founder would do.
But sometimes you don't have a choice when you fall in love with
That's very true. At the end of the day, you're falling in love a little bit to see that idea grow. And like all the challenges that come along to with that growth are things that you have to tackle as a team. So one of you will have to, I mean, Charles has been a great example of this. And at different times, they've had to take the accelerator, put off the accelerator in terms of building and being engineers and go out and do raises, go out and, you know, talk to customers, like do all the other things that are associated with a startup that aren't pure engineering.
I think Outtripping had a great mix of talent in their one. We were envious of Outtripping. Indie was great in the blogging scene, and they had another developer and a CEO was guiding them. And that we were jealous of that. But I think we defined our roles, and yeah, it's hard. It depends on the team, on the people.
We've got a few more questions. Go ahead.
So what's the right stage for a startup to join Angelcube, right in the infancy or when you actually have a product or a prototype? What's a great stage to join?
That's one. Maybe that's a good one.
We walked in with a product. We had built that and we found there was a network in Australia we couldn't access. So that's why we came to Angelcube. And we thought we had something that was awesome until these guys pushed us and said, do you have product market fit? Is there a value proposition in your product? And we failed and we made it better. But whereas like these guys walked in for product, you walked in for product, pretty much CoinJar was the only guys who didn't have a...
Etasker
didn't have it. And the CoinJar guys, they had a 19-year-old brain man who could... He was ridiculous. Like he built their product in a week. And but it depends on you, the person. You could build it in a week, or you could walk in with one. If you've got an idea now, I'd go home tonight and start building it, because Adrian will pull you apart when you get in, like, and make sure. And technically, he'll pull you apart too. He pulled me apart in the interview. He keeps pulling me apart technically now. So it's.
You had a couple of questions from the internet.
So we have a question from Amitozi, who asks, I'm curious whether any of the speakers had any failed ventures before securing a seat with Angelcube, or how many failed ventures is probably a better question.
One for us, two for us. We tried to do what eTask is doing. And similar to that, we tried to build Yammer at the same time Yammer was building, and we didn't go to market fast enough, and Yammer went to market, and it was awesome. And then we tried to build Hot or Not in an app, and it was awesome, but it failed too. But we learned a lot from it, and it was,
I didn't have any failures in my whole life previous to this, just varying levels of success.
I don't think I had the time to fail. I came into Angelcube when I was 19, and it was the first thing I'd properly done. But in my mind, a failure doesn't have to be a big crashing, burning explosion. It just has to be something little that you do that doesn't work. And if you treat that as a failure, there are hundreds of things that I've done throughout the course of Tableau and with other projects that I've taken on that haven't quite worked. And the mentality has just got to be to recognize it's not working and keep on building.
We started with a flash deals site for ecotourism, and turns out those two things don't really go together. Complete failure, but what we got out of that was a community of really engaged, passionate travel bloggers and writers that wanted to be part of something bigger. So that's sort of the failure led, to our kind of eventual, well, we were on the way to success. So yeah, I guess we learned from that and built something better from it.
Yeah, I don't have anything to add.
And there's one more from Sean, and he asks, if we don't get into the program, what are the best ways to approach investors?
That's a good question. Approaching investors, I mean, it's probably getting involved with the community. So like the Lean Startup community, all of you guys here tonight, that's one network. There's also the Inspire9 network, there's the York Butter Factory network, so there's all of these networks of people where you find not only startups, but also mentors, advisors, investors who are all like, you know, listening more and more to these spaces. And it's growing. So we're seeing more and more venture capitalists. We're seeing more and more angel investment groups. We're seeing more and more funds that are popping up all the time. So if you're a startup that's looking for investment, I mean, come into these sorts of spaces, start to learn about what sorts of things, chat to guys and girls who have been through the program, or our program, or have achieved some sort of like investment, and start to learn about what it is that investors are looking for. Yeah, okay. Charles's comment was make investors chase you. So have everything in your pocket that you need to be able to be appealable for an investor. That's probably the best way of going about that. So go ahead.
In terms of potential customers for an idea, what kind of size are you looking for? So you look at the idea, you looked at your idea and you thought, well, this is the size potential customer base. Sure, you've got to play with that and try it out. What kind of size are you looking for? Is everybody looking for this huge global market, or are they smaller and larger?
To answer your question, I guess like in order for the numbers to match up, so if you're a small team and you're looking for investment, you're going to be giving away chunks of equity. In order to make that add up at the end of the day, then you sort of need to have a whole bunch of turnover. To have a whole bunch of turnover, you need like a quite large market. And to have a large market, you need to be hyper scalable. So the things that tend to tick those boxes are globally scalable businesses. That's not to say if you had a business that would be able to saturate a particular market in an area, that would be out of the question. Like there's still the ability to go ahead and do that. So for example, often a typical strategy is to saturate, say for example, a market in Australia, like a progressive modern country with a consumer base that you can model off other areas of the world. So you could saturate Australia and then look towards Europe and look towards the States and look towards Asia. So it's not necessarily the idea that you're a global company from day one, but definitely thinking about what that looks like and how your product might interact with those markets is an advantage. If you are a startup in your infancy and you start putting numbers on a slide deck, like it's a pretty sure indication that you're making numbers up. So I think a lot of it has to do with just where your sites are set. So if it makes sense to us in terms of the people who are on that panel as to whether you can make that work and sell enough of your product to a market that wants it to make the numbers add up, then we're sold. Any other questions?
What kind of attributes do you look for in the application in regards to the person, personality, or the idea itself?
Sure. So it's team, essentially, with a little bit of idea. So team is in like whether you guys have worked, whether your team has worked together in the past, whether you have like good diversity in your team, so diversity in skill sets, diversity in ideas, diversity in manners and whatever, in a whole bunch of different attributes. If you ship something before and failed, huge, like second time co-founders or
third and fourth time co-founders tend to be statistically more successful than first time co-founders. So it's definitely something we recognize because they've been through that process of iterating, they've been through that process of failing. They know the surefire signs of jumping off the the sinking ship. So all these sorts of things are very helpful. Sorry, what's that? Go ahead.
What kind of startup do you consider, like apps, making apps, or engineering startups, like designing products and buying the market? So what exactly is your kind of application exactly? What kind of startups do
you want? We're up to like hydro startups.
Basically mobile apps, mobile communication, or can hardware
side. Well, I mean, Phil's just gone embarked on a venture to make a hardware light bulb globally, like scalable. So there's different ways of doing it, whether it's spending months and months on a plane over to China to negotiate deals with manufacturing and distribution plants over there, or whether it's sitting in a room tapping away and tapping all of this stuff on AWS, making sure that it can scale out on a cloud platform. Like, those are two different ways of making your startup globally scalable. But at the end of the day, it's about that high growth. Cool. All right, one more question, maybe? Go ahead.
How many applications did you have last time, and how many did you fund?
Did we fund? Yep. So we had up around 200 applications. We interviewed 20, and from that 20, we chose 7. Yeah. Awesome. All right. Guys, I want to thank the teams for coming up.